Science and Technology, KNUST, from 1952 to 1959, becoming the first female lecturer. In 1959, President Nkrumah created the Academy of Learning with nominated fellows. The existing National Research Council, which was responsible for research of the applied nature related to national development, was merged with the Ghana Academy of Learning to become the Academy of Sciences. From 1964, Dr. Letitia Obeng was employed as a senior research fellow in the research section of the Academy of Sciences, which at the time was run by the Fellows of the Academy of Learning, which had been then renamed the Academy of Sciences. In 1967, the Academy was split into the Academy of Arts and Sciences, GAS, and the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR. Dr. Letitia Obeng was elected Fellow of the Ghana Academy of Sciences in 1965. She was among the few fellows who published in the proceedings of the Ghana Academy of Sciences. By the time of her death in 2023, she had been a fellow for 58 years. She served as a vice president of the sciences section of the Academy in the year 1989 to 1990 and delivered the three Academy memorial lectures, as had been already mentioned, but I repeat all of the three again. The J.B. Dankwa Memorial Lecture on the topic Environmental Management and the Responsibility of the Privileged in 1980. Then the Ifremamu Memorial Lecture on the topic A Portrait of Cultured Patriotism in 2001. And then lastly, the Kwame Nkrumah Memorial Lecture, the topic Kwame Nkrumah and the Sciences in 2005. She actively contributed to other literary activities of the Academy. Dr. Letitia Obeng was elected the first female president of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2007 after 42 years of being a fellow. She wrote The History of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, A Perspective. Her presidency of the Academy was marked by introduction of highly innovative projects and programs. As part of Ghana at 50, Jubilee celebrations, she led the Academy in organizing a major exhibition of the products of all scientific and research institutions in Ghana, in the country. She also initiated the Fellows Parliamentary Pairing Scheme to improve communications and promote collaborations between scientists of the Academy and members of the Parliament. She also authored the only exhaustive history of the Academy and donated a mace for the ceremonial use of the president. She was the first scientist to be employed by the National Research Council of Ghana, and she delivered the Caroline Haslett Memorial Lecture to the Royal Society for the Encouragement of Arts, Manufactures, and Commerce in 1972, titled Nation Building and the African Woman. Through her work on the ecological changes and environmental implications of the evolving Walter Lake, and following her active involvement in the UN Stockholm Environment Conference, she joined the United Nations Environment Program, UNEP, in Nairobi, Kenya, first as the officer responsible for water issues, and later as the director of the UNEP Regional Office for Africa, and UNEP representative to Africa, with responsibility for Africa's 50-odd sovereign countries and their environmental problems. Dr. Letitia Obeng has received several honors, including Ghana's first National Science Award, the Biological Sciences segment, and the Life Fellowship and Silver Medalist of the Royal Society of Arts of the United Kingdom. In 2005, she was honored with Ghana's highest national award, the Member of the Order of Star of Ghana, MSG. Her many writings have specifically covered issues related to water and the environment. Her autobiography, A Silent Heritage, also linked to the environment, richly recalls historical, cultural, educational, religious, and other aspects of life in Ghana. She then received an honorary doctorate of science degree from KNUST. In 2016, Her remarkable and outstanding life was chronicled by the Network of African Science Academies, NASAC, Women for Science Working Group, in their publication, Women in Science, Inspiring Stories from Africa. Dr. Obeng was principled and also passionate about the Academy's work. The Academy has indeed lost one of the women advocates in the country who would always stand up for the right thing to be done. She was a visionary and an inspiration to generations of scientists in Ghana and beyond. Her contributions to the sciences and policy have left an indelible mark, and her legacy will continue to inspire generations to come. The Academy joins the children and family to honor and mourn the late Dr. Letitia. May God bless her and give her soul perfect rest until the last day of resurrection, when we shall all meet again. Dr. Letitia Eva Ama Tichibia Obeng Deye, a great scientist, Nantu Ye. Thank you.
Thank you, Emerita Professor Kwachi, Vice President of our Sciences Section. Is the Director General of CSIR here, or a representative? Okay, thank you.
The President, Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, Vice President, Fellows, I stand on established protocols and bring you greetings from my Director General. I'm the Deputy Director General, Professor Marian Dorcas Quayne. I read the tribute of Dr. Letitia Eva Tichibia Obeng from the CSIR, that's the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. Dr. Letitia Eva Tichibia Obeng, FGA, was born at Enum in the Eastern Region on the 10th of January 1925. She was the sister of the late Madame Theodosia Oko, the designer of Ghana flag. Her father, very Reverend E.V. Asihene, was the moderator of the Presbyterian Church of Ghana, and her mother's name was Dora Asihene. Dr. Letitia Obeng was the first Ghanaian woman to obtain a degree in zoology and the first to be awarded a doctorate. Her bachelor and master of science degrees were both awarded by the University of Birmingham, and her PhD was awarded by the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine, where he studied the black fly and its relevance to river blindness. She became very familiar with freshwater courses in North Wales during her PhD studies. In 1959, Dr. Letitia Obeng moved to the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR, formerly known as the National Research Council of Ghana. Dr. Letitia Obeng was the first scientist to be employed by the National Research Council of Ghana. In 1965, she established the Aquatic Biology Institute, which she directed for over 10 years. The institute's mandate was to conduct research in Ghana's huge man-made Volta Lake and its inland waters system. The institute had a research vessel and studied the fishery ecology, water quality, macro and micro invertebrates of the lake and other freshwater bodies. She was the architect of a very important conference on man-made lakes in Africa in 1968, which culminated in the book man-made lakes in 1969. She was the first woman to run a research institute in Ghana. The institute was later merged with the Water Resources Research Institute to become the CSIR Water Research Institute. CSIR will remember Dr. Obeng for her passion to make sure that Ghana's water bodies were studied ecologically so that at any point, the state of these water bodies would be known. In 1997, she received the CSIR Award for Distinguished Career and Service to Science and Technology. She was the first female to receive such an award. Additionally, the CSIR, a laboratory in the CSIR known as the Letitia Eva Obeng, was named after her in 1997. She mentored a lot of male and female scientists in Ghana and especially in the CSIR. We mourn the passing of a great scientist who contributed a lot to aquatic research in Ghana and has been a role model for all, especially women in science. May her soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you. Shall we have Professor Akosua Adumakwampofu read a tribute on behalf of University of Birmingham Alumni Ghana Chapter.
Good evening. President of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, Vice Presidents, past Presidents and past Vice Presidents, Fellows of the Academy, family and friends of Dr. Letitia Obeng, ladies and gentlemen, good evening once again. I must make a disclaimer. I am not an alumna of the University of Birmingham, but I share with Dr. Obeng a long relationship with the University of Birmingham, as well as the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, of which I am an alumna. Professor Elizabeth Adefio-Shandorf, who should have read this, is unable to join us tonight. Tribute to Dr. Letitia Amatechibia Eva Obeng. On my own behalf, I find it an honor to be able to read this tribute. The University of Birmingham, UK, alumni in Ghana have lost their most senior member, a very committed person, Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng. Dr. Obeng was a trailblazer par excellence, having earned a BSc from our alma mater before this country, Ghana, gained independence from the United Kingdom. The story goes that Dr. Obeng opted for science at Achimota to avoid housecraft, which was one of the stereotyped subjects expected to be studied by girls in those days. One aspect of the housecraft course was the practicals, which involved polishing the wooden floors of buildings of that era. She hated the smell of the wax used for polishing. Whatever the outcome of this story, we, the alumni of the University of Birmingham, UK, claim its benefits by having Dr. Obeng as our own. She certainly made us proud. We could walk the campus of Edgbaston with her achievements in mind and aim high for success. In our interaction with Dr. Letitia Obeng, she encouraged us to put our Birmingham degrees to good use for ourselves and our communities. She herself used her Birmingham degree to climb to the pinnacle of her career. In addition to the highest national award in Ghana, that is the Order of the Volta, she was given several distinctions of honorary degrees and various acclaim in Ghana and abroad. We salute Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng. We feel a collective sense of pride that an alumna of the University of Birmingham contributed immensely to environmental issues and gave advice for their solutions all over the world. She shared her experiences with us, She was ready to join us at our reunions to meet University of Birmingham alumni representatives from the United Kingdom, and also at reunions of only alumni living in Ghana. We will miss her dearly. Our deepest condolences go to her family, to the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, and to other institutions with which she was associated. May she rest in peace. Nanti ye. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Adumako Ampofu, for graciously accepting to read this tribute, even though you were not the one originally scheduled to do so. Next is a tribute by the International Water Management Institute, and after that we'll have another musical interlude.
The presidents, vice presidents, and fellows of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, all protocols observed. My name is Dr. Olufunke Kofi. I'm the country representative for the International Water Management Institute, IWMI. IWMI is located in Colombo, Sri Lanka. At the time that IWMI was associated with a disease, there was no idea that IWMI would be in Ghana. So we are very happy to be part of this celebration of life. I speak on behalf of the Board of Governors and the management team, as well as the entire staff of the International Water Management Institute. We are deeply saddened by the passing of renowned Ghanaian scientist, Dr. Letitia Obeng, senior. We are also very closely associated with the junior, who also served on IWMI board at some point. Dr. Obeng had a long association with IWMI. From 1986 to 1991, she was an invaluable member of the Board of Governors of the International Irrigation Management Institute, IIMI, as IWMI was known at that time. So IWMI started as an irrigation institute in Sri Lanka, and at that time, she was the first female African to serve on the board. There was no African at that time when she was there. She was also the chair of the nominating committee of the IIMI Board of Governors from 1990 to 1991, when IWMI did not even plan to be in Africa. Dr. Obeng's association with and contributions to IWMI continued after her tenure as a member of the Board of Governors. In 2015, IWMI opened an office in Ghana. There was an office that started in 2001, by the way, but then a new construction took place on the campus of CSIR, and she was invited to open up the office. At that time, she had opportunity to interact with the board of 2015, and she narrated during the event how she survived as a scientist in the country at that time, when during her days, almost majority view was that water was not worthy of sustained full-time research. And various views notwithstanding, through her diligence and comprehensive multidisciplinary program of work, the Institute of Aquatic Biology that she established grew and metamorphosed into an expanded water research institute. In that 2015, at the time that she met with the board of IWMI, was exactly about 50 years that she established the Aquatic Research, Aquatic Biology Institute on the same spot where IWMI's building is presently. So for her, it was a great event for her, and she termed it as the icing on her beautiful cake, which kind of like a milestone in her career. It's It was very wonderful. She wrote back to IMI board how she was very happy to be part of that event of opening up an international water research institute to amplify what she had been doing in her early years, 50 years earlier. Today, IMI exists in Ghana as a testimony and an endorsement of the Institute of Aquatic Biology's initiative and a confirmation of the importance of water resources research and management that she never imagined would have happened. The IMI Board of Governors, the management team and staff offer sincere condolences to the family. She was a role model for female scientists. I'm particularly happy to have been associated with her in the last few years, as she will be remembered for her immense contributions to science and freshwater ecology with deepest gratitude. May her soul rest in perfect peace. Thank you.
Thank you for that uplifting tune. And thank you, International Water Management Institute, for that tribute. We'll have some more tributes, this time by individuals, all fellows of the Academy. And we'll begin with one by Professor Abba Bentel Andam, fellow and former president of the Academy.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, permit me to stand on protocol already established as I remember Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng. For me, it is a real pain to have to write a tribute to Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng, because I had got used to her so much and I was seriously hoping that the Lord would take her to 100 years at least. She was born in the same year as my mother. But once I got to know her, Dr. Obeng embraced me as a colleague and a friend. I just walked to her house one day and knocked to be given audience because I wanted to tell girls in secondary school about her, when it was my privilege to be part of the Ministry of Education project called Science Clinic for Girls. So later I found that that was how she received everybody. You would think that such a person, a very important world-class person, would have child security. You will have to fill forms to be requested to see her. You would think that she had a trainload of household staff, but there she was. You know, I just went and knocked and spoke to her. And I found her to be a lady she was never a lady of vain promises. I remember that every task she set out to do, she accomplished that task, and she finished to fine detail. She would mention an ongoing project only when she was far into the project, or when she had finished. Like, you know, I made a maze for the academy. I found the piece of land that the academy secretariat is to be built on. And I remember that official life also pervaded her private life. She was refurbishing her house in Kumasi, and she was going from Accra to Kumasi, barely spending a night. And that was a time when I had the privilege of knowing some of her relatives. Dr. Obeng, if she wanted a certain shade of paint for a certain wall, she would try to mix various colors until she got that shade, and the artisans were to stick to that shade. I remember her zeal and her efficiency as president of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, enthusiastically leading the academy to celebrate Ghana at 50. She traveled the length and breadth of the country to ensure a brilliant exhibition. And at the academy, she was fearless. As president, she knew what was going on in the academy. If something was happening, she knew exactly. She would say, "Abba, asemesi enyobinting ono yesadino," and she would be right because she knew what was going on in the academy. But she was fair, and she was compassionate. And I remember that she said to me, she had in her possession the travel notes of her father, the moderator. And these travel notes were in the vernacular. She was going to translate from the vernacular to English. And she did that because she had a very firm command of Ekwapim tree and also oral and written command of the Gwan language. Once I went with her to sign a book of condolence, and that person was a Gwan. I saw that after she had written in English, she then added a written aspect in written Gwan. I remember also that this book by her father in the vernacular became a book that several reverend ministers commented that what her father had observed and what Dr. Obeng has translated and was sharing was applicable to life at this time as it was during her father's time as a moderator. And I remember also that well into her mature age, she said to me that she was putting together her as yet unpublished manuscripts into a book. We remember that that book came, was a brilliant publication, which I think will serve as a reference material for generations yet unborn. She was a true patriot. Because I remember on the phone, she said, "Oh, Abba, mekoje mi Ghana card." How many young people at that time had taken their Ghana card? And here was a senior lady getting up at the crack of dawn to go and join the queue to get the Ghana card, which had been introduced by the government because she felt it as a national duty to do so. And of course, there are many, many other sweet memories of Dr. Obeng, which I will always remember, cherish, and keep. My deepest condolences to her children and to the family. Farewell, Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng. May God give you a peaceful rest. And I thank the Lord that He made it possible for me to know you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for sharing those memories, Professor Abba Andam. If Professor Jonathan Ayete, a fellow of the Academy, will read his tribute. Thank you.
You probably think I'm taller than Abba. President of the Academy, past presidents, and officers of the Academy, family of Dr. Obeng, ladies and gentlemen, a tribute to the memory of Dr. Letitia Obeng, FGA, past president of GAS, by Professor Jonathan Ayeti, FGA. Dr. Letitia Obeng, a phenomenal scientist, has gone home. She was also a phantom mentor. Although a zoology graduate many years after her, our paths did not cross until after my admission to the Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2004. Dr. Obeng must have a way of identifying young scientists and fellows who would later serve as her mentees. When she assumed office as president of the Academy in 2007, she had a collection of S, and here, no titles: Abandam, Victor Gajiku, Mama and Tramensa, my good self, Jonathan Ayeti, Ajiri Wellington, and so on, as well as some academy veterans like Nana S.K. Biasante, Eugenia Dateba, Elizabeth Adefio, Isabella Kwachi, and so on, who were also involved in assisting with some of her many projects. I was involved in an academy project to install solar lights in some village schools to promote solar energy. With Dr. Obeng as team leader and Francis Ankra providing backup support, we traveled on bad roads to survey the sites, hold meetings with community members, and so on, before and during the installations to bring happiness to these village communities. I also recall that for the African Sciences Academy's Development Initiative, ASADI Conference, in Senegal in 2007, Victor Gajiku, my good self, and Abba Andam were selected and charged to represent the president and to enable us to prepare and assist to plan Ghana's hosting of a similar conference in 2009 in Accra. There was a small drama as all three of us met to receive our final instructions. Dr. Obeng turned to Victor Gajiku and said, "You will be team leader." And turned to me and added that I was too hot, as if to explain why I wasn't leading. We all laughed. From Senegal, we reported daily to the president. As it turned out, because I had roaming facility on my phone, we gathered at each reporting point, and with my phone on speaker, we could call the president to deliver our reports. On our return, Dr. Ben would host us for lunch. She enjoyed cooking, so threatened to cook for us each time. Consequently, Victor and I worked out a strategy to host her for lunch instead on a rotational basis, with our wives joining sometimes. When ASADI eventually came due in 2009, we were much involved in the planning. What stood out clearly was a refusal to allow our funding partners to select the hotel for hosting the conference. Her point was that our partners didn't know Accra better than us, so should not be allowed to choose a venue for us in Accra. Eventually, we settled for La Palme Royal Beach Hotel. These experiences taught us many lessons and prepared us to have the confidence to undertake any assignments, no matter how difficult, for the academy. Evidence abounds with the involvement of other fellows of the academy in other projects with similar experiences. Dr. Letitia Obeng became the first female president of the academy in 2007. That is 48 years from the creation of the academy, which was then completely dominated by men. Since exiting the position, two female presidents have successfully completed their terms in the academy in the past 15 years. What better evidence of a successful mentor she was. Fare thee well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Ayete, for that tribute. I'd like to invite Nana Professor S.K. Biasanti, a fellow and past president of the Academy, to read a tribute. Thank you.
I can see that I'm vertically challenged. Mr. President, past presidents, vice presidents, distinguished fellows of the Academy, family of Dr. Letitia Obeng, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I met Dr. Letitia Obeng at Achimota in 1946 as an inner boy when she was already a holder of an intermediate BSc degree, which was a rare qualification in those days. That was equivalent to A-levels. There was no sixth form at that time. Auntie Letitia was also a celebrated high jumper at Achimota. I was introduced to her by her fiancé, George Obeng, who was my teacher in the arts and crafts department. I also met her younger brother, Kojo Esihine. However, her autobiography reveals that we grew up, albeit at different times, in virtually the same area, that is barely 800 yards from each other in the twin towns of Ifijasi and Asokore. Her father served as a Presbyterian minister at Ifijasi when she was a little girl. As a matter of fact, Auntie Letitia, when she attended my mother's funeral in 2003, seize the opportunity to visit her old home. I want to say something about her intellectual prowess and self-discipline. Our later relationship had both personal and intellectual aspects. After our reunion in this academy, she invited me to chair the launch of her book on parasites in the late 1990s and to write the foreword to her autobiography later. It was then that I discovered that she had committed herself to an amazing program of writing comprising what she called projects. She would say, oh, I've just finished my second project and I should proceed to the third project. All these took place after her retirement from the United Nations. The writing program produced the following major works: the treatise on parasites, her acclaimed autobiography, editing, completing, and publishing the book of her late brother, Professor Sihine, on the history of art in Ghana, the Ephraim Amu Memorial Lecture, the Kwame Nkrumah Memorial Lecture, the Anthology of a Lifetime, and finally, the History of the Academy of Arts, of the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences. Indeed, she was intellectually active throughout her whole life. She told me on the 18th of January this year, that is after her 98th birthday, that my presentation of my new book to her was pushing her, in her own words, to complete her one-third incomplete book. And the remarkable thing about her prodigious output is that she was not actuated by commercial considerations. For example, she gave me about 20 copies of her book on parasites to be distributed to the school children in my traditional area. She was genuinely and passionately committed to the dissemination of knowledge. Now, a few words about her dedication to the Academy of Arts and Sciences. Auntie Letitia, who was elected a fellow in 1965, was extremely proud of her membership of the Academy and spoke with nostalgia about the privilege of participating in intellectual discourse
with prominent men in public life, such as Sir Arko Khosa, Chief Justice, Justice Van Leer of the Court of Appeal, and renowned academic personalities. Her work at the CSIR paved the way for her immense contribution to all aspects of the Academy. She delivered all the flagship lectures of the Academy and demonstrated her versatility in this process. Her J.B. Dankwa Memorial Lecture dealt with environmental management. Her Ephraim Amu Memorial Lecture displayed her in-depth knowledge of Ghanaian culture. I quoted a very fascinating piece on the cultural significance of the Chief's Palace in my own Ephraim Amu Memorial Lecture on Chieftaincy. In her Kwame Nkrumah Memorial Lecture, she presented us with a highly illuminating essay on Nkrumah's contribution to the promotion of science. Her book on the history of the Academy is the only exhaustive account of the evolution of the Academy. She even went to the extent of donating a ceremonial staff for the use of the Academy's president. And I recall the truly successful exhibition of the findings of research institutions, which was organized under her leadership as president of the Academy as part of the Ghana at 50 celebrations. Auntie Letitia was a great admirer of traditional culture. She was absolutely thrilled by my grand entry under an umbrella supported by my elders during the launch of her book on parasites. And I exploited her respect for tradition effectively on one occasion when she was reluctant for reasons which I need not disclose to attend an important event of the Academy. I parked my car in front of her door in full of my Hennessy regalia and ordered her to join me, pointing out that I would not move my car without her. She complied, murmuring, "What can I do when ordered by Almighty?" In short, she was committed to excellence and diligence in all her endeavors. She was a resolute and determined person who was not deterred by adversity or excruciating challenges. She shared with me harrowing stories about her early widowhood and being subjected to obnoxious widowhood rites. But she was unwavering in her determination to move on with her three children. She often told me that she grew up with her three children, but in the process, she single-handedly raised them to become successful professionals, each with a PhD. She was indeed an extraordinary person. May his soul rest in peace.
Thank you, Nana. You and I share the podium. In reality, I think that one of the good outcomes of this tradition in the Academy of having an evening of remembrance for a past president is the intimate details that we learn about the person, especially for those of us who did not know her that well. So thank you very much. This will become part of our memory of her. We'll have a musical interlude another one, and after that, we will have a brief biblical reflection by the Reverend Professor Kabna Samuajedu.
President of the Academy, Vice Presidents, Past Presidents, Colleague Fellows, family of the celebrated Dr. Letitia Obeng, friends, I'd like to bring you greetings and to thank God for the life that we celebrate at this time. When the tribute of the Birmingham alumni was written, it was sent to me to add one or two sentences. The woman left Birmingham 10 years before I was born. So although I took my PhD from the University of Birmingham, I don't come anywhere near. And I thought what I'd been writing was enough. This past Sunday, churches across the world, or let me say certain parts of the world, celebrated Mother's Day. And I like on that note to greet all our mothers. In addition to my work at Trinity, I also offer pastoral services to a small non-denominational congregation. And in the last 5 or so years, we have stopped calling the day Mother's Day. Rather, we call it Mothering Day. The reason is simple. A number of years ago, I encountered an elderly woman whose children adored her. I became a son to her, spent many periods, times in her home over different kinds of meals. And as we talk about your mother, this other woman comes to mind. I wanted to know a bit about her family during some of our conversations, especially these children who also all lived abroad and who, as I have said, simply adored their mother. I asked a lot of questions, and at some point, the interrogation was becoming a bit difficult. Some of the questions were becoming difficult to answer. That's when she told me, "Pastor, the children are not biological. They lost their mother at a very early age, and I brought them up. It's because of that story that I choose to call the day Mothering rather than Mothers, in order to be inclusive of those who may not have biological children, but who provide motherhood services in different kinds of ways." Reading Dr. Letitia Obeng's story tells me that she fulfills in every way what it means to mother. She mothered her children and others, and we have learned from her story that she was widowed at 35. And to bring children up to become what they have become is simply phenomenal, as has been said. She mothered other women in the sciences. In fact, given that she was the first to acquire a degree in the sciences, we say she mothered virtually all female scientists in this country. And we have heard about her work with the Ghana Academy. So she mothered her children and others. All these are in her life story. She mothered other women in the academy, in the sciences, and she mothered the earth from her work. Beloved people of God, we are celebrating one of the oldest fellows of this academy and her transition into eternal glory. She has been celebrated as Ghana's first female to acquire a PhD, a scientist, and as a woman, as I've been trying to say, she valued family, she valued scholarship, and spent her life to promote ecological care through her work on the Volta Lake. At least the last time I heard her make a contribution at General Meeting of Fellows, she was talking about the Volta Lake. Our dear past president, Nana Dr. SKB Asante, had the privilege of writing the foreword to her memoirs. I'd like to quote from Nana Dr. SKB Asante's foreword. "The substantive value of the book is enhanced
by the literary prowess of the author. Dr. Obeng's elegant prose sometimes turns into delightful and sublime poetry, particularly when she describes scenes of nature involving the ripple or movement of water. That's what I meant when I said she mothered the earth, she mothered nature. There are certain qualities that are associated with mothering, and they are tender care, sacrifice, self-denial, compassion, and empathy. In the language of the Akan, the word that is used to describe all these qualities, sometimes you call the person Batan. And interestingly, the word is gender neutral and used both for males and females in our culture. In other words, mothering is more about the possession of certain qualities which we see in her life than it is about gender. And so the text that comes to me as I read her life story is Proverbs 31:29. It simply says, many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. Proverbs 31:29. Many women have done excellently, but you surpass them all. You have to be proud of your mother, your grandmother. A friend of mine was traveling abroad, and in those days, when the whole village came to see you off at the airport when you were traveling, it was an all-night meeting, and everybody brought his or her counsel. But the father never spoke. At the end, he was asked to give a blessing. And he told this friend of mine, who told me the story later, her father gave just one sentence. He said, Kweku, remember the name you bear. Please tell your grand auntie, Letitia's grandchildren, to remember the name they bear. Very accomplished woman, of whom grandchildren and great-grandchildren have to be proud. Mothering has certain things associated with it. Two of them are very critical. The first is that it is symbolized by the womb. Secondly, symbolized by the breast. Both stand for fruitfulness. We experience the fruitfulness of motherhood, not just in the fact that we come from the womb, but also in our upbringing. Until a certain age, mothers play far more critical roles in our lives than fathers do. That's why when a father brings up a child, we also call him Batan, which is gendered feminine. In the Bible, although Jesus refers to God as Father, Father in heaven, God is not gendered. He is Father, yes, but he is also Mother. And so in Isaiah 49:15, God compares himself with human mothers or mothering. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yes, because they are human. Yet, I will not forget you. In other words, God is beyond the logic of forgetfulness. The womb reflects the qualities of protection, of love, and nurture. And the breasts are there to signify sustenance in terms of feeding. And there are several places in the Bible where God is imaged as mother. So, for example, Isaiah 42:14 says, for a long time I have held my peace, I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labor. I will gasp and pant. In Genesis 1:27, he made them both female and male in his image. And in Hosea 11:3-4, yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bonds of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down and fed them. Those are feminine qualities. Even God's name, Yahweh, the Yah, is feminine and Weh is masculine. So the feminine comes before the masculine. God is gendered female in some parts of the Bible. So there are a number of things even associated with Jesus in the New Testament that brings out the feminine or mothering qualities of the divine. He showed compassion towards the suffering and vulnerable. He compared his desire to save and rescue using the qualities of motherhood. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. In Matthew 23:37-38. Even the Holy Spirit is gendered female, comforter. And Jesus affirmed and respected women. Mary, her mother, was saved from her traumatic experience by being committed to John. The woman of Samaria, the woman caught in adultery, the sinful woman at Simon's party. At both his birth and his erection, those representing the feminine gender were present. And the story of the resurrection is true, and part of the evidence was because the writers had the courage to say that it was women who broke the news. In those days, their word counted for nothing. So, beloved, we must continue to affirm these motherly qualities that have also been nicely outlined for us in the life of this incredibly solid, a woman of solid worth. We have all erroneously treated God as masculine and claimed him as patriarchal. And we know how mothers have been at the wrong end of much social injustice right from the birth of Jesus, when Herod slaughtered babies and brought such pain to mothers. We know they go through a lot. And we like the way Auntie Letitia embodied mothering, the way she went through her valleys, climbed her hills, and mentored others. In Dr. Letitia Obeng, we celebrate a woman of solid worth, as I have said, who deployed her gifts, talents, abilities, her potentialities in the service of God, of country, and of the world. Indeed, many women have done excellently, but she surpasses them all. This week, there was a tribute to her from Elizabeth Ohene, and this is how it ends. Fare thee well, Dr. Letitia Obeng, you were special. We haven't gotten anyone like you. Sleep well. Many women have done excellently, but you surprise them all. May God bless her heritage. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Professor Kwabena Samwajedu, a fellow of the Academy and ordained minister of the Methodist Church, Ghana. Also, president of the Trinity Theological Seminary. Mrs. Oklu, could you give us another tune. Thank you. As this evening's event draws to a close, I would like to invite the family of Dr. Letitia Eva Obeng to give us the vote of thanks. Dr. Letitia A. Obeng, Dr. Ernest Obeng, and Dr. Eddie Obeng.
President Opokunti, and if I may stand on the protocols of everyone who's spoken before. We would have been four, because my mother actually brought up also my cousin Michael Bampo, who unfortunately passed away, so we are three. And we want to say thank you, a big thank you. I mean, first looking back, you've spent the evening together with us, looking back. We've heard from friends from when she was young. We've heard about the science. You know how much she cared about making sure that the science was written up, the research was done. The boat went out on the lake, and as a result, something real happened. She was very passionate about doing things, and people talk about her as a role model, but I'm not sure she set out to role model. I think she was just being herself. And I was 4 months old when my father died. So when people describe her as a woman, yes, but for me, she was both parents. She was a remarkable person. And as scientists, you know that evolution does this sometimes. It occasionally gives us something really special. And tonight, this evening, you've all testified to that amazing experience of getting to know her and to spend time with her, to work with her as colleagues, to know her as friends, and to know her as a teacher, as somebody who you actually spend time with. Am I right? And so, as we try to say thank you, it's very difficult because each one here has contributed something different. We started with the president setting up this evening for us. We had a wonderful prayer from Kingsley Jechere, who set us off coming from Achimota, the school, the alma mater, which she loved. She always dreamt she'd go to, never believed she'd go to it because she couldn't afford it, but she went there anyway. So we started with that view. We then had the joy of my cousin, Dr. Jomoedu, telling us the full story, the arc, the biography. And that gave us ideas, it gave us memories, and it made us realize that we were part of something which had lasted almost 100 years. And I think, like you, you felt both excited, proud, and really deeply saddened through that process. And then we had the chance to start to hear from the various institutions. And these are all institutions, and I know many of you would not be our contemporaries, which is quite hard because you'd have to be much older. But the institutions also, as they spoke, you realized that she had an impact in what she did. I learned from her that being dedicated and hard work never made any problem worse. It always made every problem better. So as we listened to the institutions, whether it was the University of Birmingham and how she actually supported them after she had retired, whether it was the Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, whether it was the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences, and she would have loved tonight with her favorite music from Mr. Amu, woven in, and you know that her husband was in the arts. She loved beauty, you'd know she loved to paint. She loved the science, and that integration, as we listened to the institutions, came through, I think, very, very strongly. And thank you, thank you, thank you so much to all of you who actually gave us a tribute. And then we moved on to the personal tributes, which I think, like you, I found very, very, very moving from Professor Abba Bentil Annam, and then from Professor Aite, and from Professor Nana SKB Asante. There are no words to say except thank you, I guess. I can't think of any other words. No, that would be thank you. I think we stop with the thank you there. So we've gone through that particular journey, looking back, and I think it's, at least for me, been a wonderful evening. And even if you weren't paying a tribute, perhaps through that process, you found it inspiring, you found it enjoyable and saddening. But also, thank you for being here. We have friends, we have people from our household, we have many of you who touched and helped her to do all the things she did. Sometimes we forget, and she would say, life lives because of lives. And that means she saw all of you as part of her life. So again, a really big thank you for that. And I guess now we have to look forwards, having looked backwards. And looking forwards, many of the things which you know she really cared about, I think she would say, the world is in a situation now where an institution like the Ghana Academy of Arts and Sciences has to step up, has to be curious, has to use the arts to produce the human qualities and the human values which make life worth living. The science has to be curious, it has to be critical, because we cannot afford to get things wrong about the environment. So that's what she would say. She would look at this whole event and she would think about the people who helped bring it together, the people who organized it, people like Professor Wellington and the organizing committee. And she would say, the energy you've put into this, help everyone focus to the future and put the energy for trying to make that continue to happen in the future. So with that, I have perhaps finally just two words. You've probably guessed what they are, so it's a bit of an anticlimax. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Let us stand for prayer, please. Let's observe just a moment's silence to remember this great woman, woman of substance, mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, teacher, friend, colleague, we'll now mention her name three times. At each mention, your response is thanks be to God. Dr. Letitia Eva Amma Techibia Obeng. Dr. Letitia Eva Amma Techibia Obeng. Dr. Letitia Eva Amma Techibia Obeng. Eternal God, we return thanks to you for this life that we celebrate today. We want to thank you for the ways in which you have used her to be a blessing. Thank you for the wonderful testimonies of her life that we have heard, her contributions to life and society, to the development of this country, mothering people, mothering scholars, mothering the earth, from where we get our sustenance. We want to thank you for all that we have heard. We pray that, Lord, we'll be inspired by her example. And as you preserve her mortal remains in the womb of the earth, we pray that her soul will find eternal rest and comfort. Above all, that her family will be comforted and strengthened in your goodness and mercy. As we leave this place, may your presence accompany us. And may the joy that we have received from her example continue in our hearts and lives. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. To God's mercy and protection, we commend you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God lift up the light of his countenance upon each one of us. May he grant us his peace now and always. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Professor Samojedu. Let me on behalf of the Academy, thank the Commemoration Committee, chaired by Professor Wellington, who worked tirelessly to organize this evening's event. And I think the other members are Professor Jonathan Ayete, Professor Mama Ntua Mensah, Professor Adefio Shandoff. Did I miss anyone? Okay, so thank you all for all the work and time you put into making this program what it has been for us this evening. I would like to acknowledge the presence of the Chancellor of the University of Ghana, Mrs. Mary Chinnery Hesse, who is here. Thank you, Madam. We appreciate your being here to join us. Let me also thank our president, Professor Kofi Nti, for his role in leading this entire program. I want to thank Vice President Emerita, Professor Kwachi. I know that she's done a lot to help the committee along. I want to thank the secretariat led by Mr. Kwachi for their role in providing administrative support. I'd like to thank all those who read tributes and or shared prayers with us. And I'd like to thank the family of Dr. Letitia Obeng for spending this evening with us. We are most grateful. And Mrs. Mawiram, I hope I got that right. Mawirami, yes. Mrs. Mawirami Abra Oklu, who has been our musician for this evening. Thank you for all the melodious tunes that you have provided for us. My fellows, especially the former presidents and vice presidents, thank you very much. It's always an honor to have you when we have an event. And everybody else who is here, thank you for joining us. Before we close, we'll have a hymn, A Time to Say Goodbye by Andrea Bocelli.